Look at this, Bill. Great driver, Toby Tobias.
1978. Toby Tobias, who, of course, accomplished so much in racing. Not only as a car builder, a great driver, suspension man, and Toby lost his life at Flemington Speedway.
Certainly a driver who will be missed forever on the racing scene. Wonderful to see that his sons, his family, have carried on that racing tradition.
Son won Syracuse just as he did.
Yes, indeed. Well, now we move into that 1978 season.
A Kenny Brightville season.
Kenny won the modified title that year.
Newt Hartman. Oh, there's the climber. He's going over. Looks like the car's trying to get back on the track, peeking over there. One wheel.
That was old Charlie Delzotti who went out over the fence.
Charlie Delzotti, the nurse.
That's right.
Yeah, yep. Okay. Newt Hartman, we mentioned, winning the Sportsman Championship. And Jimmy Brenn, the rookie title.
Carl Fryer going by there in the number four. Another driver who lived right down the road from Flemington.
All right, what?
Call the fence crew.
Yeah, boards there flying off.
Well, that's an interesting way to...
I don't remember that, but... Okay.
Folks in the camper just standing there kind of watching.
Yeah, just... That was weird. That was a strange one. 16A, trying to remember that. Can't remember that car.
It may have been Paul Rochelle.
Yeah, was it? Is that the kid underneath there?
It certainly was. Kenny Gill, remember him, Bill?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He was deaf, and I remember he won his first feature event. The crowd was standing and cheering and waving handkerchiefs.
Yes.
He couldn't hear them, so they waved their handkerchiefs and their programs.
Fine driver, Kenny Gill.
Street stocks.
Well, it looks like Richard Petty's there.
We're in the street stocks or late models. The first late model champ was Jim Wallman.
There's Jim in victory.
There's Jim. Yeah, he put together a lot of wins there.
A nice shot, too, of Harry D, the flagger on the left, and Altaz Nady.
A little bumblebee got in there somewhere.
Yeah, a little more Super Sunday action here. It's George Unfried in the VW Sprints.
Uh-huh.
VW Sprint flipping.
Looks like it's off the second... Maybe off the second turn there.
Car limping across the track here, right into traffic. Whoa! Even the cameraman took off on that one.
Back to URC.
Leroy Felty in the pink number two.
Mm-hmm. Scat's car, was that?
Yes, indeed.
Mm-hmm.
Wayne Rice.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, he took a wild ride. Ken Johnson.
Ken, another driver, always impressed me. A fine, steady chauffeur. Could always be counted on to finish right up in that top group.
I don't think Ken ever drove a Sportsman. I think he started out the modified.
Yes, I believe he did around 1974.
A nice slow rollover, parts flying nicely off the car. I mean, it certainly wasn't slow to the driver. But
Sonny Dornberger, 99, driver's pouch, gave that a good ride.
That Loreno on the outside in the 125?
Yes,
or
it was.
Someone else? I'm not
Roger
certain.
Loreno in the 125. And there's Tom Gilman making a nasty one. Mark Fusco.
He is early in his career.
Yeah. Head of the refreshment stands there at Flemington.
Yeah, Mark's food stand. Has that great homemade soup.
Frightening fire. Casey Huff. Remember that one, Bill?
And now the
chief electrician. Yeah.
But he got out of it all right, but he was burned. He was
there
burned
he
pretty
there.
Badly, too, walking to the ambulance. This is when Billy Pouch really came into his own in the modified division around 1979.
Yes, indeed. There's Billy coming by right here.
There he is, still riding that 15.
Yeah, a moment ago, too, Bill, I just saw the 39 go by. Remember young Nick Schlau?
Nick Schlau. He took the Sportsman Championship.
Right.
Nick retired now.
Yeah, noted speed shop owner, car builder.
Oh, there goes one. All right. Jeff Hanna. in the rookie division, and Jim Wallman for another championship, late models.
There's Tim Pouch just flipping there. Billy's brother now runs Enduros very successfully.
Yeah, king of the Enduros. Notice these cars, many of them go in and the rear end just lifts in the air. They got a tremendous force there.
Frankie Schneider.
The old master.
Ran the very first stock car race at Flemington and continued right on moving it.
1969 modified champ without winning a feature event.
You saw Dave Kneisel go by, the late Dave Kneisel in the 7-Eleven. Tell you, Bill, you look back at these films and it just kind of amazes you. It brings back the memories of all the greats who ran at Flemington over the years. Look at this shot here. Beautiful. Oh, up and over.
I was waiting for that. Something just had to happen. Up and over and out.
Almost wound up in the barbecue there with the campers.
Oh, here's a great angle shot.
Fred Orchard.
Freddie Orchard there. He had a bad flip there, too.
Stan Plosky up high.
That's a three car.
Yeah, Stan Plosky in there. Bob Fisher, it looked like.
And he does it right in front of it'll stop in a second, Bob. There it is. It finally stopped right in front of the crowd.
This is the Michael Brothers car, the 51M. I
51M,
remember.
Yeah.
Don Taylor gave that car some great rides. Sammy Beaver's there with the Horton 33. Just took a flip, too. Remember Pop Klein, Bill? Larry's dad.
He remembers that one, too. That was
indeed. Lou Lazzaro.
Oh, Lou Lazzaro. Not too many trips to Flemington for Lou. One of his few appearances there.
Jack Bertling there in the 58.
Oh, yeah.
Midget driver.
Yeah, three-quarter midget driver.
Is that Barry Laird, it looks like? Yes, indeed.
Barry. It looks like that might be Barry. Back to the Stockers, late models.
Is that Clyde Cox there?
Mm-hmm.
It was a wild division when it first started. Jim Wallman again.
There's Jim.
Two-time champion in the division.
URC.
Is that Paul Rochelle?
That looks like Paul Sandy Rochelle in there. Two-time URC champ. As a Bauer car, I believe, there. Was that Wiley going by?
Sure looked like him.
Mm-hmm.
Bobby Albert in the 96. Now we're in the 1980s, certainly a most exciting era here at the Flemington Fair Speedway. Behind me is the car of Ray Bateman, a car which is in the museum here at Flemington. Ray was a very popular local competitor who passed away from natural causes in the late 1980s. He was also quite an athlete, competed in the Olympics in the early 1980s in luge competition. Now, the 1980s here at Flemington was the time of Billy Pouch and the Modifieds. We also saw many great open cockpit races, from midgets to the sprints to the USAC Silver Crown dirt cars. It was a great time indeed, and now let's take a closer look at it.
1980 modified champ Larry Klein. And there's Freddie Adam in the number one.
And Don Menzel in the 1X.
All right, picking up the decade of the 1980s. Things haven't changed from the 70s. Still that same action, Earl.
Hey, there it is, I'll tell you. 1980s, Bill, a most exciting era there at Flemington. A lot of great names coming in week after week. And you can see some of this furious action here. There's a young Fritz Eppreit.
Yeah, young Fritz Eppreit is right. But he already had a win in the Flemington 200 under his belt at that time.
Exactly.
A rare flip of, it looks like, Kenny Bright, Bill?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
How many times did you see that?
Not
very
often.
Rare.
Not often. Well, the action is the same. that wooden fence on the outside, still sucking the cars in here.
Clay Butler, driver there in car number 5 involved. Here's Billy Cannon in the 23. He was the 1980 Sportsman Champion.
Sure, a consistent driver. All right, out and over, and we disappear from sight.
Out in the campground there. This is that Danny Barker, Bucky's son.
Danny Barker for a while. He drove a couple of years over and over and back on its wheels again. That's what we want to do, have them land back on their wheels.
Say Billy Pouch there in the Acela 121.
Mm-hmm.
And the statewide 3 car. A lot of great drivers ran that at Flemington.
We'll see Pouch in a number of different cars now, as opposed to the 70s when he was in his 15.
Well, Bill McCarthy in the 726 mm-hmm. goes for a hard one.
There's the A car.
Barry Shank, owner of that number A, has fielded some top cars over the years, hasn't he, Bill?
Yeah, there's Billy Canning, and he certainly has. He's been around a long time. And... well, a flare-up underneath there.
It was Darrell Carmen going by there in car number 2. Sportsman champion, made that the rookie champion there, rookie and the sportsman.
Quite a year for the Carmens. Darrell Carmen winning the rookie championship. Dean Carmen, the late model.
Yes, brother act there. Elvin Felty, remember
Elvin,
that night?
Elvin, that was, he not only flipped, but he was T-bone and crushed from the rear end besides. Three car action. Here's a double flip.
See the fuel pouring out of that one car there.
And testing the outside boards there.
It's like Phil Hare at 325.
Over to the sprinters.
This is the statewide sprinter. Jim Horton ran that quite a bit.
Oh, doing a little wheel-to-wheel there, the 98.
It's like Brian Seidel.
Brian Seidel.
Leroy Felty, I believe, in the 2. Is that Harry Benjamin in the 0?
Uh-huh, that's exactly what it is, Harry Benjamin. He got upside down a couple of times in open cockpits there at Flemington.
Oh,
more than a couple, I think.
Yes, indeed. Seemed like he either won or flipped.
Now, there's a wicked one.
That was Don Wolf. I recall he was leading the feature that night. John Drucker. Statewide highway car.
Scatson Peugeot car. Back to the late models. Very much a part of auto racing at Flemington through the 1980s. Dean Carmen taking top honors in the late model division. Coming out of the 80s, the great 1980 season into 1981.
Mike Corcoran, 1981 late model champion, going by in the 357.
Looks like Clyde Cox behind him.
I think so, yes indeed. Matt Slowinski in the 14.
Mike Corcoran won the late model championship.
Yes indeed, fine driver. He moved right on through the ranks, right up through the sportsmen into the modifieds.
This is the year that Art Lentani got his start in racing, rookie,
indeed.
1981.
Certainly proving that that rookie division was such a great idea, as so many fine drivers came up through the ranks. Hard ride there. You say, Bill, things don't change too much from decade to decade.
The more they change, the more they remain the same.
Exactly. C.D. Coville.
Yeah, picking up some dust there, getting through the corner. And there was a lot of it during the 1980s.
Well, Rich Pollens is taking a wild ride there out of the ballpark. Bill, you know, as we're looking at these photos here, you notice the photographers shooting on the inside of the track. Kind of brings to mind, you know, some of the great names who have shot through over the years. You know, fellas like Ace Lane, of course, and how about John Riley? Boy, that fella, he's taken so many great pictures over the years. He was kind of a fixture in that first and second turn area.
Well, John's been around as long as I can remember, and he was right there, and he did. John knew where to position himself
yes.
to get the best shots. He's always there on top of things.
Yes, indeed. Almost had a sixth sense, as it were. Knew it was developing.
There's Lintani, the Art Lintani. Daryl Carmen, the sportsman champion. Art Lintani taking the rookie honors. And a great season for Billy Pouch, 1981.
Just a moment ago, there we saw Joe Luzzi in the toy car taking a flip down the backstretch. Speaking of flips.
Yes, speaking of flips. All right, here we are. Now we're starting to mix it up a little bit here through the corner.
It was Paul Fitzcharles, as I recall.
Paul Fitzcharles, yeah. Glenn's brother.
Wayne Markovich, who owns the 96, he's fielded cars at Flemington a great many years.
And there's an outside move. Was that Lintani there in the middle?
I believe it was.
Mm-hmm.
Billy Pouch, I believe, flipping over there.
Hard to say through all of that smoke and dust, but that's the car that took a lot of feature event wins, the L car.
Kenny Brightbill on the 19.
Uh-huh. You notice the slight change in the body configuration, though, the styling from Kenny Brightbill in the 70s.
Exactly. You know, you kind of look at it here, and you see the way the car is beginning to change, getting a little more modern. Look at the flared fender on that one car there.
And speaking of change, there's a car that had its body changed around
yes.
a little bit in the split second, the wink
yes.
of the eye. A little fishtailing there, getting through.
J.R. Krause, the 8. Boy, he goes for a wild one.
Yeah, J.R. A little explosion under that.
Again, Bill, as you notice, the cars are beginning to have that
mm-hmm.
little different styling.
Not a drastic change, but you can see it. Here's the winged.
Right, the Superstocks.
Cars that Paul Kuhl named the Superstocks.
Yeah, here's a good example.
They were faster.
Yes, incredibly fast.
I believe they were getting around in the 18-second bracket even then, the winged.
Good shot of the midgets there
midgets.
At speed. Ronnie Dunston is
number
one.
What? This is probably SMRC. There's Ronnie Dunston a couple of times taking the SMRC championship, Super Midget Racing Club.
Yes, indeed. John Heidenreich in the Bollinger 80.
Yeah, there he is. Quite familiar with Victory Lane, John Heidenreich.
Yes, indeed.
Well, he's doing quite a dance there.
Boy, that's
it's kind
for
of
sure.
a disco job, wasn't
yeah.
it, for the 1980s?
Yeah, there's Rick Kuhl.
Yeah, general manager Rick Kuhl.
Yeah. Yeah, he ran the mini stocks, the VW Sprints there for a number of years in this early 1980s.
Yeah, there's Rick again.
Rick's in car number 3. Jack
looks
Hesley,
like he has a bazooka sticking out the back there.
There's the famous Flemington Cushman cart there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we move into 1982. There's Guy Howie, rookie champion that year. And matter of fact, look at that, 1926. There's his dad, Jim, over there on the right. He owned that sprint car right there, that big car that Lloyd Brushner drove. And Jim Howie was an Essex dealer back in 1926 in Flemington, lived over there on Pennsylvania Avenue, not too far from the track.
And over 50 years later, his son going on to become sportsman champ there in Flemington.
Track gets tightened up there, cars jamming up in the corners.
George Kostolansky came into his own in 1982.
Indeed he did.
Taking the sportsman division. Cool. Up and over, how many times have we seen that through the years?
Too many to count. Ray Bateman right there. As this old sedan hits the fence there, Bill, we're kind of looking at this period and fewer and fewer of the old coupes and sedans still around.
Well, it's rare that you even see one on the racetrack today.
It was a great time indeed with those cars, though.
Even in the 80s, they were disappearing quickly.
Yes. Again here in 1982, Ken Bren was the modified champion. There's Joe Coverdale. Again, to come
Joe.
Into his own there. He was the ad man. Remember they used to call
him? Oh, yeah,
that?
The ad man. Owned his own newspaper there in Hunterdon County.
Carl Fryer, waiting for a hard ride down the backstretch.
Carl lived just across the street from the track. Then he moved to, retired from racing, moved to California, and come back and still racing.
Yes. Well, Bill.
Quick change of body design there.
I wonder if he asked the track officials to give him a lap. Trent Mack 74 in the outside, the L car inside.
L
two
car.
Of the hot running cars of that era. Well, here's the little L. I recall that. That was
hey, he's looking for the right groove there. He's trying down low. He's trying in the middle. He's going to get up high. And oh, this is the quick way around the track.
Experiment.
Up here. Look at this. I'm really moving.
Yeah, there he goes. He was moving.
I guess the groove was on top of the fence.
That's what you call learning by trial and error.
He went from low to middle to high.
Yeah. Scott Purcell.
There he is, Scott Purcell. Okay, he's became a two-time sportsman champ. I never realized the cars bounced so much. They bounced like a golf ball.
Yes. One X9 there. Looks like Dave Bodine.
Yeah, it's kind of look. That number was covered with a lot of dirt and mud. Bodine.
Well, Bill, all the years you were announcing at Flemington, you realize you called so many flips?
No, it's very. This brings back memories, of course, of seeing a lot of action there, but I didn't realize there were that many flips there.
Well, I'll tell you.
Come to think of it, when I really think about it, I guess I do realize there were that many flips up there.
See Mike Welchek going by on the outside, that number 28 coupe.
That looks like maybe a fair date. See the tents up in
yeah,
the back?
Yeah, I think it is.
Okay. People in the trailers up there getting a bird's eye view of debris on the track.
Big Tom Hager in the 76.
Mm-hmm.
Alan Johnson,
yeah,
fading Flemington.
Well,
Doug Wolfgang, everybody came in and won the Silver Crown.
We're talking about the Indy cars, the Silver Crown division.
It's John Heidenreich in the 80 and the midgets. Hey, Flemington has a wonderful history of open cockpit racing, as much as the stock cars, you know, and it's great, always great to see the midgets and sprints there.
Mentioned John Heidenreich, of course. Remember his dad, Freddie Charles?
Oh, yes.
Was in competition there, too.
Indeed. There's the Paul Cool midget, number 8.
Yeah, there it is.
Look at this one, though.
Oh. I think he had just purchased that car.
That's what I had heard. I forget who the driver was.
What if it's guaranteed?
There's Rick Cool again, by the way, number 3 going by. You could say Rick Cool kind of learned the business from the ground up, learned the track by racing on it before he took over as general manager. Nice shot of the sprints here.
Kevin Collins.
Yes, indeed.
Kevin Collins, who's so successful, has been so successful on the asphalt.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Hard crash there at 880.
He knows how he steered that car, flipping up the outside of the track to get out of the way of the others. Give
That's
them room it. To get underneath me.
Well, as we see the late models here in action, 1982, we recall that Clyde Cox III became late model champion. Here too, Bill, you can look as we see Gary Raymond going by, a big winner there at Flemington in the 80s, how this late model class really developed over the years.
The early years, the late models were, almost like demolition derby cars or enduro type cars, and you can see them now, the body styles, the configuration of the cars, and they're getting cleaner, neater looking.
That was Clyde Cox III, and again, he won the title and had a few rough outings on the way to it, but there he is. It was okay after that flip, though. So here we are, 1983, and there's Scott Purcell with his number 27.
Coming out of this 27, great admirer of Stan Plosky.
Yes, indeed.
Lining up on the front.
Matter of fact, look at that, Bill. There's Scott in the middle as a young man with the hat there.
Scott Purcell in the middle of the hat. On the far right, that's Phil Cox. Both of them became champions.
Isn't that something to see? Mm-hmm. That's great.
And there's back now to Scott, and
there's
Phil Cox. Well, little guys great. There, weren't they?
Yes, indeed. That
they
was
both admired Stan the man. And who didn't admire him?
That's right. I tell you. Inspired a lot of young folks in the stands there to get into racing, I'm sure.
Oh, look at this one.
Yeah, as we continue with
Rolls
the action.
Up on the top of the fence. Little flare up
there, yeah. Action here in 1983.
Scott Purcell, we just saw Scott as a little guy, and then, of course, on the speedway in sportsman competition, and he took the sportsman championship in 1983.
And for the sportsman newcomers that year and the rookies, it was Fred Loesch.
Freddie
Loesch. Look at Joe Luzzi going out there, taking a light pole down.
The poles went down. Job for Casey, the electrician.
Yes, indeed. There's Les Katona, K3.
Les is one of the few drivers who's in about every decade that we have, I think.
Mm-hmm, I believe so. Started back in the 1950s.
Good angle shot.
Oh, beautiful indeed. Famous Flemington broadside. Oh, it's Hal Bunting in the blue hand car.
Harold 30. Bunting. I remember that one well. Oh, funny.
Dave Bedine, number 69. Oh, Guy Sheldon loses everything there. Fortunately, Guy was okay.
Call the scrap metal dealer on that one.
That's about it. Frankie Schneider still in action.
There's Frank, still tooling it around.
Height of that wheel coming off that car, too.
But the fence stays in one piece.
Knows
that
right.
Fence is still there. Didn't put a hole in that fence.
Nice looking old coupe there. Get a little high with it. Oh, too high. Well, Bill, that's why we don't see the old coupes anymore.
That's right. They're in junkyard heaven. That was a great, that was a trait of the track. You notice the right rear catches and it would throw the front end in, and then the car would catapult off the fence and then come down sideways and end up with the flip.
That was Bill Dubovic. Remember that,
oh,
Bill?
Oh, I remember, yeah.
Driving the Critelli.
It was scary at the time that happened.
Billy Couch in the 15. As I recall, Bill Dubovic was leading a heat that night when he caught a wheel and went out over the fence.
You don't often see Billy upside down, Billy Pouch, over on his side.
He came back out and he was running with a little
sheet
metal repair.
Little wing there.
Yep.
Ken Brand, of course, 1983, winning the modified championship.
There's Rusty Marion, though.
Yeah, there's a name, Rusty Marion.
Fine local driver, competed there each and every Saturday night. Craig McCaughey in the 301. Ken Johnson again. Trenton Mack 74.
A lot of altitude there.
I think that was Bob Pollock had that number 48, took that flip.
These look like they might be champ cars.
Gary Bettenhausen.
That's Gary Bettenhausen. What an enjoyable division of racing this is, especially at Flemington.
That was Billy Pouch in the 74, as I recall, that night. And World of Outlaws, Sammy Swindell.
Mm-hmm.
Might have been Skip Surridge in that flip there.
I was trying to think. Maybe you are right. Is that Stan Plosky again?
Stan.
And Paul Kuhl's midget.
Yes, indeed. Mm-hmm. That had the Pontiac motor, didn't it, Bill?
Yes, Pontiac.
It's Carl Fryer and the Ray Plaxis number 5 midget going by, the orange one. Was that the 47? That's Carl Fryer. Okay. Right, yeah. Carl Fryer.
That could have been Fryer's, one of his first midget rides. My wing, where's my wing? Get that wing back on there, I can restart this race.
Gary Raymond there, the 1983 late model champion. Here's a nice shot from the grandstand.
Mm-hmm. Les Katona.
Powering into turn one there.
Drove the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s. 1984, former rookie champion, moving right up through the ladder of the sportsman division into the modifieds and winning a championship in 84 was Frank Cozy.
And Scott Purcell repeated as sportsman champion that year. There's Billy Osmond, Bill, and the number 0, the Congolium car.
Rookie division saw Vinnie Brown come on to take the championship in 1984.
And in the late models, it was Ed McCarthy. Scott Purcell with a little body work there, Bill.
Six cars going at it, doing it.
That was Les Farley, the late Les Farley, driving that gold number 1.
Oh, yes, Les Farley.
Eddie Brown going by right there in the number 11, as you mentioned, the rookie champion, the
rookie
black
champion.
And yellow car. And there's Ed McCarthy.
There he is, taking top honors.
Late model champion. And Frank Cozy.
Mm-hmm. 1985. As they move into the corner.
right
looks
through
the
decade.
Looks like that's coming out of the number two. A little bullet job along the outside fence.
Right at the gate. 1985, the year of Billy Pouch winning the Modified Championship.
Yeah, he was putting the championships together in rapid-fire order year after year.
Scott Kenya there winning the Sportsman title. Dave Whitty in the number seven, fine runner. He won the Rookie Championship that year.
And Clyde Cox III, the late model.
Billy Pouch in the five there, Bill.
Yeah, in the 80s, as we mentioned, he was in several cars.
The Trent Mack car in 1985.
That the 64? Was that the 64? That right? Maybe Ken Johnson behind him.
Look like, yes, indeed. Scott Purcell, 27.
Osmond.
Billy Osmond in the zero.
Checkered flags being waved up there by Harry D. And Billy Osmond in victory lane.
Billy, another driver who won in a variety of decades in a variety of cars.
Over 30 wins for Billy O.
Now his son, Willie, carrying on that family tradition. Well, what a shot, huh? How'd you like to be that cameraman?
Here's the, this is the angle I enjoy right here. This tells it all.
Notice here too, Bill, as we've moved down into the mid-1980s, the famous wooden fence is gone. We're having that steel guardrail now, and that saved a lot of cars. Still had some rough ones there, but that metal fence kind of stopped those cars from being hooked into it as much as the wooden fence did.
1986.
Billy Pouch came back to win another modified title. And the first year at the small blocks were in action.
Small blocks in action, and Jimmy Horton.
Yes, indeed.
Came on to take the small block championship, and that Dave Whitty guy.
Yep.
Still taking top honors, this time in the sportsman division. Late models.
Phil Cox.
And Butler.
Yes.
In the 68.
There's Phil Cox right
there
in the silver
17. Okay. Phil Cox, that was the late model champion, and Butch Pletcher took rookie honors.
Well, Bill, that fence was still a little bit tough right there. And Ken Brennan in victory lane. Billy the Kid in car number five. Billy Pouch in the midst of some of his greatest years at Flemington. Recently, I caught up with Billy at his shop. We're here at the Pit Stop Race Car Shop in Frenchtown, New Jersey, which is the home of Billy Pouch, Flemington's all-time modified feature winner. Bill, you started your racing career in 1975 at the famous Flemington Square. Do you recall that first night in the rookies, kind of what it meant to you and what your experience was?
Well, actually, I tried to start in 74, but we did make one race out there, and the following week when I came back, they found out I was underage. I was only 17, and at the time, you had to be 18 in New Jersey to drive, so that was actually my first actual time around the track at Flemington, and we had planned on going to Middletown that day, and we left for Middletown, and we kind of got lost on the way. I wasn't really sure how to get there, and we turned around and decided, well, we'll go back to Flemington and give it a shot to get in, and I did get in, and I did get to run a race or two, and it's kind of real vague in my memory how it went, but my father, he was he didn't ride up with us, and he ended up going to Middletown. He thought we were there, and we were actually at Flemington, you know. And that was actually my first time there. But the following year, I was legal 18, and I could run there, and we started out running rookies. And it's kind of hard to remember the first exact race, but I think it was a race between me and Roger Lorino at the time. He had one of Norsch's old 81 coupes, and I think he ended up crashing three quarters of the way through the race, and we ended up winning the first rookie race there that we ran.
Do you recall when you first were planning on driving a stock car, who you talked to? Did you talk to your dad and some of the veteran drivers to get some pointers about running Flemington, because it was such a challenging track?
Well, my father, he never had much luck there. He ran there off and on. He more or less preferred Middletown over Flemington because a lot of people didn't like the shape of Flemington. And I remember going in 75, and Dick Havens at the time, he was a pit steward there, and I talked to Dick, and he just basically told me, he said, you know, this place is a square, and just your biggest thought in your mind to keep in there is try to make a circle out of a square, kind of diamond it off and put a circle in a square. And I took that advice, and that seemed to be the best advice I ever got to run Flemington.
And of course, as the years went on, you won race after race there at Flemington, and you began to approach what many considered to be a unbreakable record, the all-time win mark held by the late, great Al Tasnady. And of course, you eventually did break that mark, and again, that must have been quite a feeling for you to take that record and knowing that such a great driver before you had held it for so many years.
Well, it's something that I didn't really plan on when I started racing there. You know, I mean, you always go out and you try to win races, and with races comes championships. And, you know, as the years go on, you put a lot of wins together, and then you start looking at the record books that you might have a chance to beat them. And, you know, Tasnady was one of the best at Flemington, and it took me, you know, 10 or so years to get up to beat his record, and it wasn't easy. It was a lot of hard races and stuff, and you know, we had, since Paul Cole took over, he put in a lot more twin 20s and triple 20s and 420s, so that helped the effort a lot to try to, you know, put a lot of wins in the book doing that. But you know, to pass somebody like Al Tasnady in wins and top his record at Flemington was pretty impressive to me.
And Bill, the Flemington fans, they've been great over the years. They're tremendously supportive, and I know they've cheered you on over the years, and you've gotten certainly a lot of support from them in the grandstands every Saturday night.
Oh, yeah, Flemington, out of all the tracks I've run, seemed to have the best fan support. I mean, after the races, I'd sit there, and, you know, it'd be hours after the races are over, signing autographs and answering everybody's questions. And, you know, we'd always have a crowd of people around the trailer, and I enjoy it, you know, and it's good for the kids and stuff to answer all their questions so they understand all about racing, and that they come back every week. But they're a real dedicated bunch there at Flemington as far as fans are concerned.
And here's one of Billy's inspirations, his mom, Anna May, after winning a Powder Puff Derby. And there's young Billy Pouch getting ready to go to the races with his dad, Roy, and the crew. And there's Billy on the tractor. And the next generation, Billy Pouch Jr. What will the future hold in racing for this family?
And here we are, Nick Benora, the number 81. Nick Benora Jr., five-time ARDC champion in action.
It's like Dave Kelly there, Bill, in the 17.
Yeah, the winningest active driver in URC, 76 wins or so, over the inside guardrail.
Rod Reppert going
over
there.
Yeah, Rod Reppert.
Glenn Fitzcharles.
Yeah, Fitzcharles, a four-time URC champ.
Well, now as we move into 1987, there's Gary Butler, had that great year in the late models.
Something like 19 straight victories.
Incredible, and there's
a
Gary.
A lot of them anyway, a whole bunch.
Look at him run that groove on the outside. Very smooth chauffeur. Now we saw Fritz Eppreich going by there in the John Katzenstein 265. Fritz won the small block modified title that year.
And Mike Corcoran getting the job done in sportsman cars.
Like another driver who came right up through the ranks.
Oh, there's
Bob Ringen. 404.
Yeah,
what a ride.
And puffing it out, giving the fans a real treat there, the first turn. Jim Macaluso in the rookie division, Cooktop Honors in 1987.
He's a fine driver, came into his own that year, won that rookie title, and little was really heard of him after that.
As Jimmy Horton goes by in the 85.
Well, there's a great shot here. Of course, 1987, Billy Pouch continued his winning ways, winning the modified title once again. Here's Billy. You're going to take a ride with him, Bill.
There you are. Whee! Isn't this fun?
Well, I'll tell you what. That's hanging on for dear life there as you ride with Billy Pouch. Interesting, Bill, looking at that shot there, the varied grooves that the drivers used, all coming off the corner differently. There's Jim Horton taking the win.
Jim posing after one of his many victories at Flemington.
Bruce Thompson, URC, president for a number of years of that organization. It's like Jerry Dinnan in the 16.
Jerry Dinnan out of Connecticut. Mm-hmm.
It's like Glenn Clark, I believe, 85. Yes, indeed. Well, that was a driver who, his name kind of was synonymous with that wreck, Bob Ruff. Remember him, Bob Ruff? A rough ride. Here's an old rookie.
Flemington's oldest rookie ever. That's Jimmy Horton Sr.
As he moved now into 1988.
Nice clean shot here.
Howie Kranz, hometown favorite, won the small block modified championship. One guess who won the modified title that year, Bill?
Let me see. I'll take a wild guess. Just a wild guess now. Don't hold me to it, but I'll say Billy Pouch.
You got it.
Oh, boy. Imagine all the drivers I had to choose from, and I picked Billy Pouch. I wonder why.
That's it. Hey, there's Brett Hearn. He had some good rides here at Flemington.
Yeah, he managed to put together the extra distance victories there.
Glenn Fitzcharles, we just saw. 1988, also a great year for a young man named Tim Tanner, winning the rookie championship.
Dave Hertz in the late model division.
That was Jack George just taking that tumble there.
Oh, that was a nasty one, too. Speaking of nasty,
Tom Warner in the 58.
Tom Warner out of Reading, PA. 1989. Seasons are going by, aren't they?
Well, I'll tell you.
89. Billy Pouch in the modified division again.
And another second-generation driver, Willie Osmond, the small-block modified champion.
That Willie Osmond in there.
Ray Bateman there in the active one. Here in the end
Bateman
of his great
right in the
career.
Middle of the late Ray Bateman. Bill Tanner out of Newtown in the sportsman division. And Paul Rochelle III as a rookie launching his career.
Bob Travelline in the late models.
Bob Travelline later moved up into the sportsman ranks and has done very well. Bob Travelline from West Trenton. Hooper, Bruce Hooper, looks like they're on the low side going in.
Well, Bill, I'll tell you, if you look back over the years, again, all the years that Billy Pouch won the modified title, there's Doug Hoffman in the 125. Quite easy to say that Billy Pouch was the driver of the decade of the 1980s at Flemington. There's Mark Kenyon, colorful number 17. Well, here's a famous night, Bill. Recall that Billy Pouch set what many felt he broke what would be an unsurmountable record.
Well, many thought that the Al Tasnady record of 96 victories would not be surpassed, but Billy did it.
Well, we started 1915, and here we are over 75 years later in the 1990s at Flemington. And with me is General Manager Rick Cool, son of Paul Cool. And Rick, you've worked with your dad here at the track for many years, and you've seen a lot of changes. You kind of grew up with this track when it was the fastest clay track in the world, and now here it is, we're standing on the new asphalt surface. What does that change mean to you?
Well, Earl, it's been a big change for us in the way we put races out for the fans, and then going over to asphalt. It was a tough decision and a big decision for us, but things change, and you have to change with the times in order to keep going. You can't stay stagnant, and we saw it coming. We're government regulations and problems, you know, with the town would eventually force us to be an asphalt speedway. So we made the move when we could make it on our own terms, and right now we're in the process. We're still in the transition period and developing what works, what doesn't work, and the asphalt speedway is coming along.
And the racing is just as exciting as ever, isn't it?
The racing is as exciting as ever. It's for an asphalt speedway. It's more exciting than most dirt speedways. Mm-hmm. And Flemington Speedway has always been an exciting speedway, and you can't come here with the idea that it's just an asphalt speedway. It's an exciting speedway, and the way the track is shaped.
And you're absolutely right, Rick Cole. The way the track is shaped. The famous Flemington Square. Flemington, one of the most talked about speedways in the United States because of its shape.
And as we move into the 1990s, 1990 to be exact, that same challenging square. Here's these drivers fighting it there. We saw Jimmy Long a moment ago with the M23. And here's rookie driver Billy Shank launching his career.
Hey, we've seen that A car a lot through the years, haven't we?
Yes, we have. Beautiful shot here as the sprinters power through. Not so beautiful for Bruce Bowen, who hits hard and flips his car. This was during a World of Outlaws show.
And not a good day for Bart Martin either. Watch. Bart Martin will be coming along in just one moment. And there he is. He's okay, though.
A little shaken, but he's beginning to climb out.
He's going to move out of there.
Well, there's the four abreast World of Outlaws start. On the outside, we see Steve Kinzer, who won this World of Outlaws show that night.
And Steve went on. There he is there.
And, Bill, we're approaching the end of an era right here.
Well, we've seen a lot of changes on this speedway, mostly the cars through the years, but now the biggest change of all taking place, that broad slide, and we move into the asphalt era.
1991. Mark Fusco going by there in the Mach 4, Dick DiRica in the 1.
Hey, wait a minute, Earl, where's the dust?
Not to be had, just tire smoke. So Bob McCready invading there is Ralph Rue.
There's the same old photographers there, though. They haven't changed from the dirt track days.
Still capturing the action. Danny Johnson in the 28. And some things remain the same. There's Billy Pouch in the 15.
The last, the first modified champion, I should say, at Flemington, Doug Hoffman. The Supers. Giving the Flemington 5/8 mile asphalt a test. Supers coming down from Oswego.
I'll tell you, the first time they were on this speedway, and they really adapted quickly and put on a great show for the fans that night.
Down in the 15-second bracket, up over 140 miles an hour as the street stocks move out of the fourth corner and down the front.
And with the paving, a lot of new drivers coming in to test the Flemington Square. Here's one getting a little bit high. Looks like the dirt track days.
Where's the foam? Now, we used to have, I think we have some, there it is.
It's like he's plowing snow there, Bill.
Number 14.
And the late models now. Of course, one of the drivers who competing in the late models at Flemington is Sammy Beavers, who has gone right through the decades, started back in the 1960s. And is the 1992 Flemington Late Model Daytona Series champion. And Sammy recently came back to Flemington, kind of to check things out, and we had a chance to talk with him.
Sam, you had many good years here at Flemington, of course, starting off with the novice division back in the 1960s and moving now right up into the 1990s. What kind of inspired you to get into racing here at Flemington years ago?
Well, I used to come down here and save a lot of seats for the town boys and stuff. I was real young then, and me and my cousin used to come down. And we kind of got started that way. Guys were going around. And back then, there was a division, kind of like a fun division. And a couple guys actually had radios in the car. And you didn't need uniforms or anything like that. And we built a car in the backyard, me and my cousin and the town local boys. And we brought it down here, and we started competing to it. And it was a lot of fun.
Sam, moving into the era of the 1970s, early 80s, you, of course, moved out of campaigning your own car to driving for other owners. And I recall you had many, many good years with people like John Norsha, for example, with the 81s.
Oh, John Norsha. You know, one of the main things that I liked and I campaigned with these guys is we built most of our own cars. I mean, John Norsha built 90% of his car. I think he bought one Whit Mulligan car way back, but we built most of our own cars. Jim Horton was a big car builder. He built all of his own cars. And Jim Fodor, the 13. I mean, I drove good cars, but we handcrafted the cars. And there was more rules back then. There was, you had to make your own springs and stuff like that, and the torsion bars were out. And then it got more sophisticated where you went to the speed shop. And I don't know if that's right or wrong, you know what I mean? Because you're spending the money, but the time factor is really cut down,
right,
too. I mean, you can build a race car a lot faster, mm-hmm, but I think that's why I'm so knowledgeable on racing is, right, because we built all our own cars.
And the last midget race of 1992 provided some great action.
This was a barn burner. There's Nick Fenora Jr. going by in the number 25. But coming on strong is Drew Fenora. Look at the pass he makes on the back through the short chute and down the front to take the checkered flag. And greeting Drew Fenora in victory lane is the great A.J. Foyt.
So here we are, Bill, the Chamois Shine 200.
There's an immediate spin coming off the fourth corner, right at the green flag.
Sean George running into problems there. Now, interesting mix up front. Kevin Collins is in the 44 junior for this race. Doug Hoffman in the number one. And, of course, Doug Hoffman had won the modified championship at Flemington in 1992 with that 44 junior.
There he is, and he repeated from 1991 in the Romeo number 44. But it's Kevin Collins' day in the Romeo number 44 in the Chamois Shine 200.
Yeah, he gave it a great race. Here he is dueling with Doug. I'll tell you, the 200 always has a great tradition of racing, whether it's on dirt or asphalt, and the fans certainly weren't disappointed this day.
Billy Pouch in the 1A going by, all bunched up.
Young Kevin Joey Collins, McCarthy, yeah, there in the 10 gave it a good run, too.
Kevin Collins started in the front row along with Doug Hoffman. There's Kevin Collins, the winner of the 200. And the Altaz Nady Hall, part of the National Old Timers Hall of Fame, filled with memorabilia, sprint cars, midgets, a great attraction in Flemington.
So much wonderful history here. Look at the young fans, Bill. Isn't that great to see, looking at that history there?
And here we have the cars in the Race of Champions, kind of the big grand finale for the 1992 season. And that number 55 on the outside is the eventual winner, Lenny Boyd. What a story behind this win. Lenny Boyd didn't have a ride just a few days before the Race of Champions. Took a car that had flipped just the month before and caught fire. They patched it up, brought it to Flemington. Lenny Boyd went on to chalk up, I guess, the greatest victory of his career, Earl. Oh,
absolutely. And, of course, the Race of Champions, which began at the famed Langhorne Speedway, now has a new home at Flemington. And that tradition of great racing with the Race of Champions, it followed through in 1992. Look at this great finish here with Lenny Boyd.
Lenny Boyd will be coming around to the victory lane. There he is, being greeted by the happy crew. Congratulations, Lenny Boyd.
For over 75 years, the fans have sat and many times stood in these grandstands, cheering on their favorites here at the Flemington Fair Speedway. And they've seen them all, the great drivers and the modifieds, the sprint cars, the midgets, and even the Indianapolis dirt cars. They've seen some of the greatest racing ever, and it's been right here at Flemington. And that racing will continue as part of the great tradition of this speedway for many years to come. I'm Earl Krause,